You gotta call him by his name. If you want...
I am not discouraged. I am confident, because when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise a standard against him.
In the restoration age, the restorers ought to be more powerful than the reformers.
God has talked to me and settled my mind. God gave me lessons. God went over this thing step by step, Paul is saying, with me and persuaded me. Until now, I have no doubt. I'm persuaded. I got no doubt. I have no fear.
Jesus is my everything. Everything, everything. Ain't nothing outside of Jesus. It's all in Jesus. The fullness of the Godhead. All in. He said, I'm Alpha and I'm Omega. I'm the first and I'm the last. I'm the beginning and I'm the ending. Beside me, there is nobody like Jesus.
The living God, God manifest in the flesh, the man that came down from the heaven to this earth to walk amongst us. Where did we get that revelation? From the oil. When that oil begins to flow, when that oil lights the wick, the light begins to shine, and we begin to understand who he is. It's not three persons, it's three officers.
So you have to see, it's in the name of Jesus. Please, my young preachers, I pray that we're giving you a good lineage. But if we're not, don't get caught up with buildings, fine clothes and cars. It's all right, but above everything else, you gotta have Jesus. In the name of Jesus, devils have come down. In the name of Jesus, your child will be set free. In the name of Jesus.
From the upper room in Acts chapter 2 to the Azusa Street Mission in 1906, Pentecost has long been characterized by the rushing mighty move of the Holy Spirit and the unity of people from every nation baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Preachers and prophets have lifted their collective voice to declare the truth of Acts chapter 2, verse 38, and the message of the mighty God in Christ. The history of the Apostolic Pentecostal Church is one of revelation, salvation, demonstration, and integration. The Day of Pentecost Celebration Foundation stands as a city on a hill that cannot be hid. In a day that is filled with turmoil, the Day of Pentecost has fully come. This is the people who are with one accord in one place. This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. This is the Spirit that giveth the utterance. This is Pentecost.
We welcome you to a night of Pentecost. This is Pentecost Sunday evening, 2020. And what an eventful night we have. It's going to be a great time of receiving the Word of God, reaching out to God just as they did on the day of Pentecost. I know these are unique circumstances, and so we're very thankful to have the opportunity to share with you via technology the Word of God on this Pentecost Sunday evening. Pentecost Sunday is always an exciting experience, but it's especially exciting in the city of Cincinnati, Ohio. The Pentecostal community, the Apostolic Pentecostal community in Cincinnati is bound together by the love of God, by the sound doctrine of the Word of the Lord, by the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, and has been for a number of years. We thank God for every general and every giant of the apostolic faith that has gone before us in this great city to lay a solid foundation upon which we now walk and go forward in Jesus' name. We never dreamed we would see this kind of an experience that we've had over the last couple of months. Our theme for Pentecost 2020, before the COVID outbreak, was one accord, one place. One accord, one place. We were excited to have Pentecost Sunday, May 31st, 2020, one accord, one place. It's a theme that is inseparable from the second chapter of the book of Acts experience. Yes, we talk about a mighty rushing wind. Yes, we talk about cloven tongues like as a fire. We talk about Peter declaring, "This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel." And then, of course, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. These themes of Acts chapter 2 have come to define Pentecost. And these are themes that we continue with this year and beyond. One of those themes, of course, is the concept of them being in one accord in one place. We wanted to capitalize on that. And then, of course, as things would develop, we weren't able to be in one physical place. But we decided to keep the theme, one accord, one place. Because as you know, if you are of an apostolic Pentecostal persuasion, you know this is a spiritual body. And that, yes, we are with one accord. And yes, we are in one place. We are made to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So even if we aren't able to be in one physical location, we are able to be baptized into the same body, into the precious name that is above every name, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we welcome you tonight to a night of Pentecostal celebration. And we've got a beautiful night in store. We are so grateful to have with us, sharing the word of the Lord specifically to the Day of Pentecost Celebration Foundation and the Apostolic Pentecostal Community of the Greater Cincinnati, Ohio area, two statesmen of the apostolic faith. Dr. David Bernard, the General Superintendent of the United Pentecostal Church International, and Bishop Theodore Brooks, the presiding bishop of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. These two men of God have taken time out of their schedule to share the word of God with us, and they're preaching messages that will touch your heart and strengthen you and edify the body of Christ. We're excited about it. We're thankful to them for coming to be with us. Our first speaker, Dr. David Bernard, General Superintendent of the United Pentecostal Church International, the author of many books that have strengthened the body of Christ by helping us to understand the great apostolic doctrines of the Word of God that fortify us and help us to draw closer to the Lord. And his ministry has gone throughout the world internationally. And he was raised as a missionary's son, and he continues that missionary ministry in his work as the General Superintendent of the United Pentecostal Church International. His message tonight, the demonstration of the Spirit, is surely going to bless your heart and minister to you right where you are in your home. Following the ministry of Dr. Bernard, we're going to hear from our first Vice President of the Day of Pentecost Celebration Foundation, who's going to lead us in a season of prayer as we receive the Word of God, Pastor Rudy Brazell, out of Greater Emmanuel Apostolic Temple. This is going to be a good time in the presence of the Lord. At this time, we welcome Dr. David Bernard, General Superintendent of the UPCI.
Greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to all the pastors, saints, and ministers in Cincinnati, Ohio. And thank you, Pastor Joel Urshan, for helping to arrange this opportunity. We appreciate all of you, United Pentecostal Church International, Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, and perhaps many other apostolic people. It's exciting to celebrate the Day of Pentecost. This is our day. It's the birthday of the New Testament Church, the first outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And we're enjoying here in the 21st century that same outpouring, but actually in an even greater measure. And so I'm thankful that God has given us this opportunity. Reading from the Word of the Lord, I'd like to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4 and verse 5. The Apostle Paul writing to the church at Corinth that he had established. In 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 4, he says, "And my speech and my preaching, was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. I want to preach for a little while here today the demonstration of the Spirit. After all, we are apostolic Pentecostal people. We call ourselves apostolic. That simply means we follow the message and the experience and the practices of the 12 apostles and the early church of the first century. We're not coming with some new doctrine. We're not coming with the various traditions that have evolved over church history. But we want to go back to the New Testament. We want to go back to the first century. We call ourselves Pentecostal because we believe that the first outpouring of the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost is not simply a one-time experience, but it's for the church today. We find it throughout the book of Acts. We find it throughout the New Testament. And there's been a great restoration and revival in the last 100 years or so. And I'm glad to be part of that revival. Let's never forget, we are people of the Spirit. We are people of the Word, of course, but also of the Spirit. We must have both. We must have a balance. We must have the demonstration of the Spirit. Now, if you go earlier in the chapter, the Apostle Paul at the beginning said, I didn't come to you with excellency of speech. I didn't come with wisdom, but I came to declare the testimony of God. Now, it doesn't mean Paul was uneducated or ignorant or unlearned. He never studied, never practiced, and he's advising us to be like that. No, actually, Paul was highly educated for his day. He was trained at the feet of Gamaliel, who was a rabbi in the first century, well known to us from history. And he also studied at least some Greek literature, because in Acts chapter 17, he was able to quote from Greek philosophers and poets when he preached in Athens. He wasn't saying that we shouldn't pursue education or study, that we shouldn't prepare messages, that musicians shouldn't practice. What he was saying was we cannot rely on our abilities and our training and our expertise and our resources, but instead we must rely on the anointing of the Holy Spirit. So yes, we should study, but we should also pray. Yes, we should do our very best, but at the end of the day, it's not going to be our talent that makes the difference. It's going to be the anointing of the Holy Spirit, our relationship with God, and our ability to walk in the Spirit. We need the demonstration of the Holy Spirit. He said in verse 2, "For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." Everything we preach should focus on Jesus. It's not about ourselves, our philosophy, our politics, our sociology, our psychology, our personality, but it's got to be about Jesus Christ. When you preach Jesus Christ, what are you going to preach? You're going to preach, first of all, that there's one true God who created us. He created the human race to have fellowship with Him, to love Him, to worship Him, to commune with Him. Sadly, we humans fell into sin. We broke that fellowship. We temporarily thwarted God's plan. But of course, God is bigger than we are. He had a plan of redemption all along. And so God gave His only begotten Son. That does not mean He gave someone else. It means He gave of Himself. Because Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is actually the one true God manifested in the flesh. So when you preach Jesus Christ, you'll preach He's the Almighty God manifested in the flesh. For in Him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Then you'll also preach that Jesus died for our sins. As a human being, He shed His blood for us. He paid the price for us. He was the only innocent human, the only sinless human who ever lived. He did not deserve to die. So He could step in our place. He took our place. He paid the price for our sins. He shed His blood for us. So through His death, we can have fellowship with God once again. But not only did He die, He was buried. That shows the reality of His death and the miraculous nature of His resurrection. Not only was he buried, but he rose again. You can't preach the death of Christ without also preaching the resurrection. If Jesus merely died, he's no different than Buddha or Muhammad or Socrates. But because he rose again, he won victory over death itself, over sin, over the devil. And he will share the victory with all who believe on him and obey his gospel. So the message of the gospel is, first of all, Jesus died for our sins. Second of all, he was buried in the tomb. Third, he rose again the third day to give us victory. If you're going to preach Jesus Christ and him crucified, you'll preach the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. But you won't stop with what happened 2,000 years ago. You'll preach how that needs to be applied to our lives today. On the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, the Apostle Peter preached, supported by all the other apostles. He preached, if you study it, he preached the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In other words, the simple gospel message. It's very significant because here is the only place in the whole Bible where you have all 12 apostles standing at the same place at the same time, preaching the same message, ending with how to be saved. Because at the end, the people were convicted of their sins. They cried out to Peter and the other apostles. What shall we do? How can we be saved? They weren't merely asking how to receive extra blessings or supernatural power. They were convicted of their sin of crucifying the Messiah, of rejecting Jesus as their Savior. They now wanted to be forgiven of their sins. They wanted to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, as their Messiah. So when they cried out, the Apostle Peter gave the unequivocal answer in Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise, verse 39, is unto you and to your children, all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Notice the command to repent and be baptized in Jesus' name is a command to every one of you. And the promise of receiving the Holy Spirit is likewise a promise to every one of us, not only for that generation, but subsequent generations, not only for that location, but for everyone God would call. That extends to the whole world through all of time until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the message that we preach today, because repentance identifies us with the death of Jesus. We die to sin and the old life in repentance. We're buried with Jesus Christ in water baptism, according to Romans chapter 6. And we rise to walk in newness of life when we receive the Spirit of the resurrected Christ. So when we obey Acts 2:38, we're applying the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus to our lives. When you preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified, you will in fact preach the gospel of the death, burial, and resurrection. And you will preach the application of the gospel through the new birth experience of repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. But you won't stop there. You'll also preach the pursuit of holiness. In the book of Galatians, Paul explains that we're crucified with Christ. We're crucified to the flesh. We're crucified to the world. What does that mean? We no longer pursue the pleasures of the world. We no longer pursue our selfish desires. We act as if we are dead to those things. Instead, we are alive to God. We're pursuing holiness until the coming of the Lord for His church. So when you preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified, you will preach the apostolic doctrines of the oneness of God, the Almighty God in Jesus Christ, the gospel, the new birth, the pursuit of holiness. All of that is what we treasure and proclaim as the Word of God in the New Testament. But my main focus here today is that we must also have the demonstration of the Spirit. We have a testimony, but we must have an experience to match our testimony. We have the apostles' doctrine, but we must have the reality of the ongoing apostolic life through miracles, signs, and wonders, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, intercessory prayer, demonstrative worship. We must have the demonstration of the Spirit in our midst. We must have the power of God, as Paul said in verse 5, that your faith would not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. If we have only a doctrine, if we have eloquence of speech alone, someone else may come with a better sounding philosophy, with even more eloquent speech, and lead us astray. But if we have the demonstration of the Spirit, then our faith will stand, because we will know for ourselves that God is real. We'll know for ourselves when we receive the Holy Ghost, our life changed, and our life is still changed. And we will see every day and every week God working to heal, to deliver, to save. We'll know God is real, not only because of a doctrine, but because of our experience that matches what the doctrine teaches. We need a demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. Not only was the first century church born in that experience on the day of Pentecost, and we can read that story in Acts, and we can see descriptions throughout the New Testament, but the modern Pentecostal revival was also birthed in such an experience. Now, there was an outpouring of the Holy Ghost at various times in history. We're seeing more and more accounts of people speaking in tongues. But by and large, at least among the institutional church, the generally recognized church, there was a great decline and loss of almost all work of the Spirit over many centuries. There are periodic revivals. There are groups of people that sought after God. There are individuals that had experiences. And then, of course, with the Protestant Reformation, there was a great renewal of faith and going back to the Bible. But actually, the modern Pentecostal movement as we know it had its beginnings in the early 20th century with a renewed emphasis on the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the sign of speaking in tongues. Charles Parham began preaching that message in Topeka, Kansas. And then William Seymour started the great Azusa Street Revival in Los Angeles, 1906 to 1909. And that revival spread the message around the world. What was significant, as I said, people throughout history had received the Holy Ghost. But what was significant about at the turn of the 20th century was now we had an organized group once again preaching, everyone should receive the Holy Ghost. And when you do, you should expect to speak in tongues. And that's what led to the Pentecostal movement that we know today. And closely on the heels of that came the understanding of water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. So we can trace our roots, of course, to the New Testament, to the book of Acts, to the original day of Pentecost. But as a matter of history, we can see how God raised up men and women to renew and restore the fullness of the experience. And so we go back in January 1, 1901. Parham's first student received the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues. Parham himself wouldn't receive the experience until a few days later. And then a few years later, William Seymour went to Los Angeles, began preaching that message, even though he hadn't received it himself. He was invited to come out there, take over a little church. He began to preach the Holy Ghost. The pastor got upset, locked the church doors so he couldn't hold service the next night. He was stranded in Los Angeles. A family took him in, the Lee family, and they began having prayer meetings and studies there in their home. He invited Lucy Farrow, who was a noted evangelist who had received the Holy Ghost, and she had the gift of faith where she could lay hands on people and pray for them, and many times they would receive the Holy Ghost. So Seymour, needing a breakthrough in Los Angeles, invited Lucy Farrow to come. She joined the little group. One night as they were praying and the group got bigger, they had to move down the street to the Bonnie Bray home of the Asbury family. And one night or one afternoon, Edward Lee came home from work. He was feeling sick. The little group was praying and fasting for an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. He asked for prayer for healing. Lucy Farrow began to pray for him, and she discerned that God was doing something. She began to pray for the Holy Ghost. And within a few moments' time, Edward Lee received the Holy Ghost, began speaking in tongues. That was so exciting. The little group went down to the Asbury home on Bonnie Bray Street. And as Lee shared the testimony of what just had happened to him, the Holy Spirit fell again and three more people received the Holy Ghost. One of them was Jenny Moore, who would later become the wife of Seymour and the leader of the music program for the Azusa Street Revival. And after Seymour's death, she became the pastor of the mission. But when she received the Holy Ghost in the Bonnie Bray house, the Lord anointed her. By her own testimony, she had never played the piano before. She went over to the piano in that room and began playing it beautifully. God gave her that gift. You can still go to Los Angeles. The Bonnie Bray home is a museum, and you can see the piano right there. Well, that ignited revival. More people began to come. The little home was overflowing. People on the porch and out in the front yard, the porch fell in. They knew they had to go somewhere else. So they secured an old dilapidated building on Azusa Street in Los Angeles. And so for Easter services, they were able to have service. And for 3 years, 1906 to 1909, day and night, they had revival. Thousands of people came from all over the United States and literally around the world, received the Holy Ghost, and then brought the message back to other places. That's where we come from. It was an interracial revival. Blacks and whites in leadership, men and women in leadership. Hispanics came, received the Holy Ghost. People of many nationalities. As Frank Bartleman, the chronicler of Azusa Street, who later became a Oneness Pentecostal preacher, he said the color line was washed away in the blood. That's our roots. That's our heritage. That's our first century heritage. That's our 20th century heritage. More than just the doctrine, it's got to be an experience that changes our lives. It must be an experience that causes us to love God and love one another, overcome the prejudices of our own background or our own culture or our own society, and pursue true holiness, both inwardly and outwardly in all aspects of our lives, to pursue miracles, signs, and wonders. What we need is the demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. It's interesting because the Los Angeles Times quickly got a hold of this story, and the first service was on April the 15th, and by the 18th, the LA Times had this headline, "Weird Babble of Tongues. New sect of fanatics is breaking loose. Wild scene last night on Azusa Street." These are some of the subtitles. "Gurgle of wordless talk by a sister." The paper apparently loved coming back to see these people. Here's some headlines in subsequent weeks. "Holy jumpers are again noisy." How about this? "Holy kickers baptized, 138. And here some headline writer got creative. "Summer solstice sees strenuous sex sashaying." He's mocking speaking in tongues. Well, the onlookers might be mocking, but there's something real. I wonder, do we still have some holy jumpers and holy kickers? I'm not talking about a precise demonstration, but we must have worship that is demonstrative, that breaks out of our shell, that breaks out of our personality. We must have an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Sometimes it will cause us to fall on the floor. Sometimes we will jump. Sometimes we will dance. Sometimes we will shout. Sometimes we will laugh. Sometimes we will cry. We will speak in tongues. We will groan in intercessory prayer. We will see miracles take place before our eyes. We must have a demonstration of the Spirit. We are a Pentecostal church. We are an apostolic church. We cannot survive just by intellectualism, and nor is it just emotionalism, but there must be a move of the Holy Spirit. Let me share a testimony from Scripture. It's found in John chapter 9. It's a story of a man who was born blind. And as you read the story, you find that Jesus met this man. The man didn't really know who he was, but Jesus had compassion upon him, gave him some instructions, said, "If you'll go to the pool of Siloam and wash, you will be healed. Wash your eyes, you will be healed. I don't know exactly what was going through this man's mind, what he really understood about Jesus, but evidently Jesus spoke with authority. This man was desperate. He had nothing to lose, so he obeyed. Now here's the point. Even if you don't fully understand all doctrinal issues, you can have faith in Jesus, and that faith should be demonstrated by obeying the Word of God. Do what Jesus says to do. If you haven't repented of your sins, that comes first. Then you should be baptized in Jesus' name. Then you should seek the Holy Ghost. Even if you haven't been baptized, you don't have to wait. You can go ahead and seek the Holy Ghost now. But our first commitment is to obey. The blind man obeyed. God miraculously healed him. By this time, Jesus was gone. But the neighbors begin to notice this man who they thought was blind, now obviously walking around, seeing quite well. And so there became a debate. Is that really the blind man? But he's seeing, so it can't be him. Maybe somebody looks like him. You know, maybe he's got a cousin that moved to town or something. What's going on? So they approached him and said, "Are you the man who was blind?" He said, "Yes." "Well, what happened? How are your eyes open?" If you read in John chapter 9, he explains, he gives his testimony for the first time in John chapter 9. You can read their question in verse 10, his answer in verse 11. He answered and said, "A man that is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash.' And I went and washed and I received sight." That's basically, as you read the story, that's all this man knew. He didn't know a lot of theology. He didn't really have an accurate understanding of who Jesus was, but he had a personal testimony. Now, we need doctrine. I've spent a lot of time talking about our doctrinal foundation. But my point right now is this. Even if we don't have a full understanding, we must have an experience with God, a scriptural experience, and from that, the Holy Spirit can lead and guide into all truth. We've got to have an experience. We've got to have a testimony. We must have the demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. So they brought this man to the Pharisees, and they begin to question him. And they noticed it was the Sabbath day, so people aren't supposed to do work. So look at the carnal, legalistic mindset. They couldn't focus on the miracle because they weren't the cause of it. So they were automatically suspicious and jealous. So they rather focused on some perceived violation. "Well, this guy is supposed to be some kind of medical doctor, is he? Well, he's not supposed to be working on the Sabbath. He's practicing without a license. He's opening his shop when it's supposed to be closed." And so they begin to criticize. And they ask, "Well, how did you receive your sight?" So you'll notice that for the second time here in verse 15, the blind man tells, or formerly blind man, tells his testimony. "He said unto them, 'He put clay upon mine eyes and I washed and I do see.'" Same testimony. He didn't know anymore. Of course, that led to this great debate. How could this guy who's violating the Sabbath allegedly, so that means he allegedly must be a sinner, so how could he do a miracle? And that's impossible. You're lying. Something's wrong. Finally, the blind man, verse 25, said, "He answered and said, 'Whether he is a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that whereas I was blind, now I see.'" Obviously, he didn't have an adequate understanding of Jesus, or he could have known he wasn't a sinner. But here's what the blind man, formerly blind man, is saying in essence. You guys are the experts. You have the doctrine of theology. You're supposed to know all this stuff. But there's a basic problem here. You, according to your theology, he couldn't do this miracle. Well, whatever he is, whoever he is, whether he's a sinner or not, I'm not qualified like you experts to give all the answers. But I know one thing that you don't understand, that you can't explain. All your grand and glorious theology can't explain one simple thing. Once I was blind, now I see. So until your theology can explain that, I have no use for your theology. And with all due respect, I have a doctorate in theology. I appreciate those who study. But the point simply is this. People can say it's not real. But when you have an experience, you know it's real. People can give you 100 reasons why all this doctrine is false. But one person who speaks in tongues by the power of God refutes all such false theology. Once I was blind, but now I see. Yes, we should study, but we must have a definite experience with God that we know for ourselves that the Bible is real, that God is real, that the Holy Ghost is real. We must have a testimony. Don't let anyone take away your testimony. We must have a demonstration of the Spirit in our churches every week. Our young people, our children, our visitors, our new converts, they may not understand everything. They may not agree with everything. They may have questions, but all of them need to see the undeniable power of God at work, and that will make the difference. That's how you build an apostolic church, the demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. So this man had a testimony. I know one thing. I was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Of course, the Pharisees refused to accept that answer. They said, how did he open your eyes? And this man evidently had a sense of humor because he said, I've told you already and you didn't listen. Why do you want me to tell you again? Oh, I know. Maybe you want to be his disciples. Okay, great. I'll gladly go through it all again if you'll follow him. Of course, they rebuked him, cast him out. And they said, we know about Moses. That's for this fellow, Jesus, we don't know who he is. And the formerly blind man couldn't resist. Verse 30, why herein is a marvelous thing that you know not from whence he is, and yet he hath opened my eyes. Notice, this is the fourth time he shared his testimony. He didn't have anything extra to say. It's the same testimony, but he stuck with it. And he said, all of you religious experts, all of you theologians, all you leaders, you can't explain one basic fact that I know to be true in my own personal life about Jesus. Therefore, I can't accept what you say. I have to listen to Jesus. It was after that, of course, they kicked this man out of the synagogue, rejected him. It was after that that Jesus showed up and said, are you willing to believe on the Son of God? And the man, in all innocence, you can see his lack of theological understanding. He said, well, who is he that I might believe in him? And of course, Jesus explained, and this man began to follow Jesus. Now, I'm not arguing against the need for study and doctrine. I'm arguing for it. But notice, this man did not have an understanding, a good understanding of who Jesus was. But he had an encounter with Jesus, an experience that changed his life, a miracle and a testimony. That's how we're going to reach a lost world. That's how we're going to reach a society where people no longer believe in God or they don't believe in Christian values. That's how we're going to attract visitors. And certainly we want to have well-designed programs and websites and music and do everything with excellence and beautiful buildings and whatever we can do, choirs. But at the end of the day, we're not merely trying to attract people based on what we have to offer in the natural. What's really going to attract a lost world and convert people to true apostolic believers is the power of God. Pastors, I appeal to you. Make sure that you emphasize prayer and worship. Make sure you lead people into a spontaneous response where the Holy Spirit can move. Make sure you structure times for prayer, even at the conclusion of a service such as this. And saints, I appeal to you likewise. Come to church in a spirit of prayer. In your home, develop a spirit of prayer. Come to worship and come to share. For as you go from home to home and as you talk to people on the job or even talking to them online or on the telephone, talk about what God can do to create an expectancy and then pray with them. because we must have the work of the Holy Spirit in our midst. Now, I know we're living in unusual times with limitations due to the COVID-19 pandemic, but let's not limit what God can do. Let me give you a couple of testimonies to show you what I mean. In April, many of our nations of Latin America with the United Pentecostal Church International have their annual conferences at that time. And this is always a great time for thousands to gather, for many hundreds to receive the Holy Ghost. Because of the pandemic, all of these conferences throughout Latin America were canceled. It seemed to be very discouraging. But some of our evangelists got together and they prepared an online service that was focusing on preaching the gospel, having a response, seeing people healed, and receiving the Holy Ghost. And I want you to know that was broadcast in Spanish online throughout Latin America. And they asked for people to text in the responses. Many people repented of their sins. Many expressed they wanted to be baptized in Jesus' name and make arrangements for that. Many were healed. Many were renewed in the Holy Ghost. But I do want to tell you this. 873 people responded that they had received the Holy Ghost by speaking in tongues for the first time. I received a picture of a woman who was 100 years old receiving the Holy Ghost in her home after watching that broadcast. Don't limit what God can do. It's time to believe in the demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. I'll share another testimony. Recently, I was able to preach in a small church in Texas where they were able to hold services again. They practiced social distancing. We had people come to the altar. Or to the front area, but we didn't lay hands on anyone. We stayed a distance. We raised our hands and we directed our prayers towards them. And you might think that's a limitation, but there was a wonderful move of the Spirit. And it reminds me of what happened last year in Marlin, Texas. I was invited to preach in a women's prison. There was a team of people from several different churches in the Austin area and elsewhere, multiracial team, just as the prisoners were multiracial. So we gathered in that confined room. I preached, and right when I was getting to the conclusion, the head guard spoke up and said, "We've got to have a roll call." So she interrupted my message, made everybody sit down, and took about 20 minutes to call off every single person's cell number to ascertain that nobody had somehow escaped during the course of the meeting. You might think that would just totally destroy the message, but I admit I was a little aggravated and discouraged, but I also knew there's power in the Word of God. So when she let me finish, I just quickly wrapped it to a close. I gave an appeal. I asked the women who wanted to receive the Holy Ghost to step forward. Now, another limitation, we couldn't touch anybody, especially because it was a women's prison, and those of us who are men were not allowed to get in their personal space or touch them because of security and abuse concerns. I understand that. But it was contrary to our typical practice. We like to pray closely with someone to receive the Holy Ghost, to lay hands on them, and maybe to speak into their ear of admonition, and sometimes shake and tremble. Maybe, I don't know if we're just excited and the Spirit is moving, but sometimes we feel like we can almost transmit that anointing or excitement if we can only shake them or touch them or lay hands on them or something. And I do believe in the biblical practice of laying on hands as a sign of faith and a focusing of faith. But there's no transfer of a substance. It's God who's doing the work. And our hands are simply symbolic of God's hands being laid on people. My point is, we couldn't have our traditional Pentecostal prayer an altar call. Instead, we lined up all the women, and we leaders lined up behind them. We extended our hands without touching them, and we asked for God's anointing. Some of our group who were women were able to work a little more closely with them, but basically we just had to inspire faith and trust God. And do you know what? In that group of maybe 200 people, in perhaps 15 minutes or less, 27 women received the Holy Ghost with the initial sign of speaking in tongues. My point today is simply this. We are the Apostolic Pentecostal Church. We rely on the power of God. So whatever the limitations of trying to preach online and trying to work through meetings one-on-one or small groups and not being able to do everything we love to do, not being able to have all that we want and expect in worship. But when we do what we can do, God will make up the difference. If we neglect what we can, then we suffer for it. But when we're doing the best we can and our best doesn't seem to be good enough, after all, we shouldn't be depending on our ability anyway. We need the demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. And so right now where you are, I challenge you, go to God in prayer and pray until you contact Him and you feel His presence. If there's someone that needs to repent of your sins, call upon the Lord, confess your sins to God, open your heart. Once you've fully done that, then you begin to worship, raise your hand, speak out verbally, praise and thanksgiving to God. If someone is with you, they can encourage you. But in a few minutes' time, you too can receive the Holy Spirit and speak in tongues. All of us, let's ask for renewing of the Holy Spirit. Let's call upon the Lord right now. We need the demonstration of the Spirit. We need the power of God. In Jesus' name, we pray.
On the strength of Dr. Bernard's message, this is a call to prayer. Prayer for the power and the presence of God to be active in your life. Let every heart pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your holy and divine presence, seeking your divine face. We're thanking you, God, for most of all, for your death, burial, and resurrection. Thank you for the baptism in your name, for being covered up under the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the Holy Ghost that leads us and guides us in all righteousness and in all truth. Lord, we thank you most of all during this pandemic crisis and our economic situation that you move in the lives of your people. God, you have saturated the church with the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost. It is to lead us and guide us in all righteousness and in all truth. It is to strengthen and encourage our hearts during times like this. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that we move in the presence and the power of the Spirit of God. Help us, Lord, to overcome individual obstacles, sickness, death, and health. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that your presence be felt amongst us and the people of God. We are the sheep of your pasture, God. We look to you, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. We're leaning, we're dependent upon you. We're dependent upon the presence and the power of God to strengthen us during these times. Show yourself strong and mighty in the lives of your people. Help us and encourage our hearts to be witnesses to those that are lost in darkness, and that the things that we do or say would encourage them to seek the light of your salvation. God, help us to spend more time speaking and seeking your presence, Lord, in our lives. Help us to continue to keep your word hid down in our hearts that we might not sin against you. Lord, we thank you for what you've done, even now for what you're about to do. Lord, let us continue to see a great outpouring of the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost, Lord, during this great Pentecost season. On the strength of the word from Dr. Bernard today, God, return people to their knees. Help them to seek your face, Lord, to seek you while you may be found, to call upon your great name while you are near, for there is power in your name of Jesus. There's healing, there's deliverance, there's well-being, there's wellness, God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you, we praise you today, we honor and glorify you, because power and dominion, majesty, Lord, all belongs to you. Lord, we thank you and honor you. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen and amen and amen. Let's just receive that moving of the Spirit of God in our homes, wherever you may be. Let the Spirit of the Lord just move on you right now in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we give you all praise for what you're doing in our city. We give you all praise for what you're doing in the great body of Christ right here in Cincinnati, Ohio. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Dr. Bernard, for that powerful message, the demonstration of the Spirit. If we've ever needed it, we need it now, the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. We give God praise. Thank you, Pastor Brazell, for leading us in a time and a season of receiving the Word of God through prayer. Amen and amen. We're looking forward so much to hearing from Bishop Theodore Brooks, the presiding bishop of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. Bishop Brooks has authored numerous books that have blessed thousands of people. His ministry has spanned the globe, and he leads the mother organization of the Apostolic Oneness Movement, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. We're very thankful and honored that he has taken the time to preach the word to us here at the Day of Pentecost Celebration Foundation. Following Bishop Brooks's message, you'll want to hear from our second vice president, Bishop Anthony Hill, who will speak to you about a relief fund that we have established for churches who will need help during this COVID outbreak. We want to make sure to fortify the body of Christ and the local churches here in Cincinnati of the apostolic faith. We're very grateful and honored to be able to join with you tonight and to shoulder, go forward to do the work of God. Bishop Brooks's message, Back to Business, is going to inspire you to go forward from this moment and do the work of God as he has called and anointed you to do. At this time, please welcome Bishop Theodore Brooks, presiding bishop of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. God bless you all. Amen to Pastor Urshan and Suffolk Bishop Daniels, and to the host of the saints that are watching in a greater Cincinnati area and beyond on this Pentecost Sunday event that is gathering. I'm so honored and privileged to be here with you on behalf of myself and my beloved wife, my Lady Janice Brooks. But we say praise the Lord, and may the blessings of the Lord be upon you. To my colleague who was also on this program today, the superintendent, David K. Bernard, I greet you all in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, and just thankful to God for what the Lord has done and how that the Lord has allowed us just to come and share with you for a brief moment. Pastor Urshan asked me to bring a word today, and we have a word from God that you will pray with us. Come on, bow your heads. Father in heaven, I thank you for your grace and for thy goodness and for thy mercy. Let your anointing to be upon us. Let your glory move in our midst. We'll be ever faithful and careful to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen, and amen, and amen. Well, I want to look at two scriptures out of the book of Acts, if you will, the first chapter and the second chapter. This is nothing new. The writer of old, Solomon, said there's nothing new under the sun. So we don't have anything new. We have the same word that is coming to you. We've heard it before. It's been preached to us before. But just hear what the Lord has laid upon this, his servant's heart. In the first chapter, in the eighth verse, their first chapter, eighth verse, it says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. That's critical. Unto the uttermost parts of the earth, unknown parts, parts that we would not normally go to. It says that we shall be witnesses unto him. And don't forget that. Now, in Acts, the second chapter, at the very first verse down to the fourth, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The subject matter that God laid upon my heart, and I take a little time to explain it, is back to business. Back to business. Now, follow me, if you will, just for a few moments. In the beginning, God says, create the heavens and the earth. And he made man. He saw that after he made man, he made woman. They were in the garden. The unique thing in the garden is not the fall to me right now, but is the fact that in the cool of every day, it says that God, the Spirit of God, came down and dwelled with Adam, and he had conversations with Adam. So it tells me that right away that God made man for a purpose to give him praise, to give him glory, and to give him honor, and to commune with man, and for man to commune with him. And from that time, we all know of the fall that happened in the garden because Adam became more concerned about the wife, the woman that God had given him, and had yielded to what she had asked him, and the devil had deceived them both. We all know as time went on that this began to have a great traumatic influence upon how man walked. Well, prior to that, we know that the devil was kicked out of heaven because he said he wanted to be like the Most High God. And the imps of the devil have been trying to influence man to walk away from God and not to be able to have that relationship with God. The intent of God was to have man that he can commune with that would be able to share with others his divine will. He told Adam of the tree in the midst of the garden, don't touch everything else that you may able to eat of. And you would assume then from that if Adam had obeyed, Adam would have then conveyed that thought to every one of his offspring and their offspring and their offspring. There's also an assumption on our part that his offspring would have continually conveyed it, do not touch the tree in the midst of the garden. We know all that was washed away when Adam failed to obey what God would have him to do. The interesting thing is, as you check Old Testament history down to the New Testament, you see where a man would have a one-time relationship with God and then fail him. Back and forth. We had the prophets. We had the priests. We had the leaders to come. They were moved by God. They had the Spirit of God upon them, not in them, but upon them. They prophesied as the Spirit of God came upon them. It's even said, Saul, amen, as he was, amen, transgressed God, the Spirit of God came upon him and he prophesied. When after he, amen, was the Spirit of God moved itself from Saul, when David, amen, would begin to play his harp, when Saul was in one of his moves, the Spirit of God would calm down everything. So we have the Spirit of God upon the Old Testament saints. They did wonderful and they did marvelous things, but it kept them from having the kind of relationship that they need with God. It would have to go from period to period. So here we are now in the book of Acts, and we are some thousands of years later, where that now Jesus has come on the scene. Amen. Isaiah said, for unto us, amen, a child is given. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Prince of Peace. God knew that man needed a more intimate relationship with God. And because of that, amen, now Jesus came on the scene. Matthew said he would come to save his people from their sins. So we came into the world so that you and I could be free from the burden of sin. The Apostle Paul writes to the Romans in the 7th chapter. He said, there were two minds within me. One mind, part of my mind, is warring against the other part. And he said, that I would do, I do not. But that I would not do, I do. It is no more I that does this, but it is sin that dwells on the inside of me. You see, the intent of God was that the whole world, man, would give God the greatest praise and the glory and the honor. Man was created to lift up and to magnify God, but because of sin, he could not do it. Because of sin, amen, he had this divide between him and God. God needed to stabilize that and to get that to the point where that there was now that barrier broken down, where man would now have the ability to have the kind of relationship with God that he needed to have and that he could tell other men about the goodness of the Lord. As you look through, amen, the New Testament, one of the things that they did was to go out and had a ongoing revival. It is said that 12 known men turned the known world upside down. 12 men turned the known world upside down. What did they do? They simply preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they preached it so that men were convicted. You remember the Apostle Paul, a man as he stood on Mars Hill and began to share with them about who that unknown sign was in reference to. Amen. And they said to him, amen, that Paul, amen, you almost persuaded me. Amen. You almost convinced me. But they did not turn around and give God the greatest praise. Paul went throughout the known world, amen, preaching, amen, to the Gentiles and bringing them together. Because at the beginning, it was just with the Jewish nation. A Jewish nation was the only one. But God revealed to Paul, who was diametrically opposed to Jesus. He wanted to kill all the Jesus believers, amen, but he was diametrically opposed to them. But God had stopped him on the road to Damascus and caused him to now have to know who he really is. I want you to understand we're talking about back to business. Follow me, if you will. And now we get to the point where the gospel is now being preached. Amen. He brings them here in this chapter in Acts, amen, and tells them to wait until they be endued with power from on high. When the power comes, it is said that there appeared unto them cloven tongues like a fire, and it sat upon them, and all of them were filled with the Holy Ghost. When they got filled, they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave utterance. You remember that as the Spirit of God began to move upon them and they began to speak, they spoke in different man's language that were there, but they glorified God. They told that he was a mighty God. They told that he was a glorious God. They said that there was nobody like him. As a result of this, we have 3,000 that are added to the church on that specific day. And because the 3,000 were added, the church had begun to grow and the church began to develop. And all throughout the New Testament, we have Paul and others going to various places and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with the people of God. Well, beloved, I need you to understand, amen, that the church began to flourish and to grow. But somewhere after the turn of the century in AD 100, there became a lapse in the church. It became a persecution against the church. And literally, brothers and sisters, up until the early 1900s, amen, there were ups and downs. There were, amen, different things that happened and different people, amen, who got certain revelations. We have great writers who came along who shared with the known world, amen, as much revelation about who God is and what God is. Amen. They knew, they understood that there was more of God. We all understand our apostolic heritage, our Pentecostal heritage, that says that there was a man in Kansas at a Bible school who had his students, amen, searching the Word of God, trying to understand what they meant about being filled with the Holy Ghost. We all know that there was a woman who, amen, was first filled with the power of the Holy Ghost. And it trickled down, and then they moved to Texas, and it went up into Canada. And then we have the great outpouring of the Azusa Street Revival, where this man, a man Seymour, a man went there and began to preach. He was locked out of one place, but God opened up a door. And in a little stable, an old barn that they converted over, a man for 3 years, the Spirit of the living God moved upon them in L.A. It spread out. It came out. We all know of Garfield Thomas Haywood, who got word of the power of God falling, a man in L.A., a man God filled him with the Holy Ghost. And after that, they begin to have this debate about whether or not they should continue to baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, or whatever else that they should do. We all know that there came a revelation, and it came to Haywood, that all three are but one. My God. And Heywood then, amen, caught the revelation, was baptized in Indiana, and was refilled with the power of the Holy Ghost. History says that some came to him and told him there was a new issue coming down. Be careful, Brother Heywood. You don't want to get caught up in the new issue. It is said that Garfield Thomas Heywood sent word back to them and said, it's too late. I've already been to the water. I've already been baptized. I've already been filled with the power of God. My God. And he began to move. We all know out of that came the Pentecostal assemblies of the world. And from that, amen, came other groups. Well, the church began to grow. We had the PAW. We had PCAF. We have Bible Way. We have UPCI. We have many independent apostolic groups, amen, that came along there after that and have been preaching the word. Well, I hear you saying to me, well then, Bishop, why are you saying, amen, back to business? What are you talking about? I only got a few more minutes, amen, so let me get down to the point. Well, I believe that God, amen, has stirred up the atmosphere. Glory to God. I believe that God has moved upon the earth because man has walked back away from God. We let isms and schisms, amen, come in to divide us. We have accepted to do, amen, things that God knows not pleased with. We became more concerned with the size of our building or how much offering that we were going to get. We became more concerned about where we can go and what we can do and how far we can push it. So what God did, he allowed, I believe, this is only me now, he allowed for this pandemic to stir us again. You remember in 1917, amen, there was the Spanish influenza. It stirred the world. It stirred the land. This was right around the time when the church was beginning to formate and come about into an organized structure, an organized body, where the power of God was falling. Amen, in 1917 and 18, amen, it blew up. Amen. Many people died. In 1919, it began to subside down. You go back and you check the history. The church began to move. Amen. Everything began to come together. We had brothers and sisters worshiping together. It didn't matter what the color of your skin was. I remember reading something that says when the Holy Ghost fell in L.A., it fell on white folk. It fell on black folk. It fell on Asians. It fell on Mexicans. It fell on Spanish folk. It fell on anybody that had a mindset, amen, to want to have a greater relationship with God. But you know and I know that the devil has been trying for years to cause us to separate and to divide. Well, God has said, I need to get your attention. I need y'all to get back to the business that is at hand. And the business that is at hand is for you and I and others like us that believe, amen, this wonderful apostolic Pentecostal doctrine to stand up and to declare to the world that there is but one Lord, there is but one faith, there is but one baptism. I believe that God is shaking the atmosphere and causing his people to pray. Pray like they never prayed before. Pray until, amen, they shake the rafters. I'm not talking about the rafters in the church. I'm talking about the rafters in their soul. Pray, pray until we hear from God. pray until God would move across the land, everywhere in the world. 190-some countries, I believe, this pandemic has hit. It has caused people, we know what the number is, over 5,000 that had caught it, 5 million rather, that came down with it. But I believe the number is far greater than that. I believe it's much larger than that. Some people could have had it and didn't know that they had it. And now they're testing now. They want to come down with the vaccine. I'm all for that. Amen. Let the vaccine roll, if you will. But more importantly, I'm so glad that God, amen, has stirred our minds and stirred our hearts until we can get back to the business of magnifying and lifting up and glorifying his mighty name. It's time, church, for us to get back to the business of giving God the glory, of magnifying God, of lifting up God. It's time, church, for us to say, no more business as usual. Now it's time to get about our Father's business. And what is our Father's business? Is to go throughout this world. Look at us. Amen. Now we're out on, amen, Facebook. We're out on YouTube. We're out on all these streamings. Amen. Declaring the word of God. Amen. More, some of us got more people watching our Bible classes, more people watching our morning service than we ever had to come into our churches. Amen. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands have heard the word, have heard that God is only one God, have heard that he is an able God, have heard that he is a mighty God, have heard that he is a glorious God, have heard that he is a powerful God. I need to tell you, we need to get back to business. I got to close now and draw this, amen, to a close. I'll come back later on. At sometimes I feel like I want to preach this again, because now, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, let's get back to God's business. Let's get back to being true saints of God. Let's get back to walking upright. Let's get back to living holy. Let's get back to glorifying God. Let's get back, amen, to declaring there's only one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. Let's get back to the glory of God, to fall in our midst. Let's get back, amen, like the old saints, where he says, let's go back to the old landmark. Amen. What is the old landmark? Where the glory of God, the anointing of God, the power of God falls in our midst. Folk are saved. Folk are delivered. Folk are healed. Folk are brought out. And we are saved more and more and more and more. It's time. It's time, beloved, to get back to business. It's time for us to go back to the old landmark and to allow God to come into our lives, to allow God to enrich us, to allow the Spirit of God, hey, God, to be upon us. I want his glory. I want his glory. That's all I want. I want his anointing and his glory to fall down in our midst. Beloved, be encouraged, but it's time now. It's time now. You got no more excuses. You can't be running to the mall. They want to open up the malls everywhere, but stay out the malls. Stay out the malls unless you're going to go there and pass out tracts. Stay out the malls. Amen. It's time now for us to get back to the business of building up the kingdom of God, because he's coming soon. Soon and very soon, he's coming. Heaven smile upon you. The Lord bless you. The Lord strengthen thee. The Lord keep thee. Let's get back to business. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you, God. Let us get back to the business of building your kingdom. My God, let us get back to where we can march and declare, sainted, we're going to tear your kingdom down. Glory to God. Let your anointing, hey God, fall upon us. Let your glory be in our midst. And Father, we'll be ever faithful and careful to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. Lord, we love you. We appreciate you. Thank you for keeping us even during this era, this time where COVID-19 is raising havoc throughout the land. Watch over your people, God. And if we lost any, God, we pray that you would cover their family, give them strength and encourage them. Let us do the right thing, all for your glory and for your honor, that your divine will be done. We'll praise you and magnify you. In Jesus' mighty name I pray, amen and amen and amen. Let's get back to business, and that is the business of God. The blessings of the Lord be upon thee.
Glory to God. Glory to God. What a word we have heard from the Lord tonight. Back to business. Going back to the old landmark. Going back to what God has called us to do. I thank God for this word we have heard as the body of Christ. It has been edifying to us. We heard from Dr. Bernard about the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and the need for God to be at work in his church. And we heard from Bishop Brooks about the need to get back to our Father's business, doing what God has called us to do, kingdom work. Thank God for this word. We ought to just lift up our hands and thank God and receive his word in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you and we give you praise. Help us, Lord, not to just be hearers of the word, but doers also. As we take this manna from heaven that we've received tonight, Lord, just let it become us and let us go forward to do what you have anointed us to do in the name of Jesus Christ. We're thankful to both Dr. Bernard and Bishop Brooks for taking the time to preach the word to the great saints of the city of Cincinnati, Ohio. The Day of Pentecost Celebration Foundation. Pentecost 2020 was one for the books. It's not one we expected to see quite like this, but we're thankful that God, who is rich in mercy and able to do things beyond what we could ask or think, made a way for us to receive the good word of God as he did. And we're very grateful for that in Jesus' name. But we look forward to Pentecost Sunday 2021, May 23, 2021, the return of Pentecost. God bless you all in Jesus' name.
What a powerful message from the man of God, Bishop, preached. And we're looking to God. We're hoping that you was able to grab hold of those words with understanding and that you will humble yourself. Come and bless and pray and let the Lord bless you with the message you heard. Seek him, call to him, look to him, that he'll guide you to a place where you can find him and be anointed by him. God is a good God, and it's by his love that we are all gathered together. Although we're apart, we're still together, both in heart, in strength, and in spirit. And we're inviting you to join us in that walk, in that work with God. We need men and women to humble themselves in this day, in this very, very difficult time. This is a time for us to look to God and count on him and call on him. Repent and call on the name of Jesus, for he is our healer and our deliverer. If you need anything, help, strength, God has it, and you can get that. We thank God for that wonderful message. We hope and pray that it has encouraged you and undergirded you and caused you to recognize the power and the anointing that God has and the blessings that he provides unto his people. He is truly a good God. And as we have the Pentecost, Day of Pentecost celebration, we have come together as leaders in the Pentecost in city of Cincinnati, and we have provided funds for churches, pastors who are having a difficult time in this pandemic. We want you to know that we're here to help you, to assist you. We're not trying to build any big thing. We're just trying to unify us and empower each of us to be able to reach the constituents that God has placed before us. We encourage you to reach out to us. You can get an application and you can get the other additional information concerning getting the financial assistance that you may need in these trying times. May God bless you. May he keep you. May heaven smile upon you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Bishop Hill. We're excited to have the opportunity
to partner with those churches who may have been affected negatively in this very challenging season. If you would like to donate to the relief fund that the Day of Pentecost Celebration Foundation is putting into place to help those churches, please feel free to connect with your pastor, and we'll be happy to facilitate with them in order to coordinate for that donation. And if you need assistance, then you can also reach out to us, and we'll be happy to provide that application to you to receive that assistance. Never has the world needed the church more than it needs the church right now. We're living in a day and an hour that is filled with strife and challenges. And this week, with the terrifying scene of George Floyd's murder at the hands of a man who had sworn to serve and protect, this was a terrifying scene that enraged our nation. And then this weekend, cities around the nation are in great turmoil. We need Jesus. We need the Prince of Peace to step into this scene. And the church, the Apostolic Pentecostal Church, is uniquely designed to confront this situation. We stand united with one accord in one place, filled with the Spirit, washed in the blood. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And so we're going to pray tonight as we conclude this broadcast and ask the mighty God to step into these circumstances, step into our world, anoint us like never before, and use us to an even greater capacity than we've ever been used. Let's do it right now. Just lift up your hands in the name of the Lord. God, we come to you in Jesus' name, asking for your mighty power to flow through our nation, your peace to cover our nation. We pray, Lord, that you will heal the wounds, the deep wounds, wounds that have been inflicted by racism that get opened and reopened. I pray, Lord, that the blood of Jesus would just sweep through your church and sweep through your nation, this nation, Lord. I pray, God, that you would help us to walk in the Holy Ghost, to be filled with faith, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name that you'll tear down every stronghold and let us walk in the boldness and the power of the Spirit of the living God. In Jesus' name, unite us together in the love of God like we have never been united before, anointed for your purpose, the purposes of your kingdom. We give you praise for this, and we declare it in the mighty and the matchless name that is above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Thank you for tuning in. I know that the word of the Lord has been a blessing to you. Dr. Bernard preached to us about the demonstration of the Spirit. We're not about enticing words of man's wisdom, but with the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Bishop Brooks talked to us about the need to get back to business. We are about our Father's business, and that's what we have to get back to doing, doing the work of the Lord. Thank you for tuning in tonight. God bless you in Jesus' name. If anybody is suited for the needs of this day and age, it is the Pentecostal Church. Thank you for tuning in. The power of God be with you. Let us walk in the power of Pentecost.